There are those who regret the roads they once chose. But more than the sorrow, more than the pain, there is joy for the way that through Christ they've been changed.
There are lives freed from bondage, their sins once concealed. There are bodies and minds and spirits now healed.
Those who found freedom should have off the chains from the long years of guilt, anger, and shame.
Power and glory in Moses' redeemed. Such tender mercy.
of the risen Lamb. all around how the nations bow down to see the only sound is the praises to Christ our King. Slowly the names in the book are read. I know the King, so there's no
take your Bibles, if you would, please, and open them to the book of Romans. Paul's masterpiece of the New Testament, his greatest work, was done in this marvelous book of Romans. And here we have the Apostle Paul addressing the issue of the problem of pain. And that's what we want to talk about today. We're in a series on Sunday morning dealing with pain and suffering and struggling and things, why they happen, why they don't, and doesn't make sense, and we don't understand it. And that's what we're going to try to do today. As we last week we looked at being bitter and not becoming bitter when we go through difficult times and pain and suffering, and not become bitter. And today we want to try to understand the problem of pain. I think if we can grasp a hold of an understanding of it, we'll be able to cope with it more. We'll be able to go through it better and greater if we have an understanding of it. A lot of people simply do not understand the problem of pain and the whys, and they look for answers and they can't find answers. And when we can't find answers, we become discouraged. And when we become discouraged, then we find ourselves, as time moves on, we become rebellious and we become bitter. in the pain and that suffering that we struggle through, and especially as Christians. Because we hear so much about all the pie in the by in the sky that a Christian's never to be sick and we're never having any pain and suffering and we'll all be healed if we do instantly and immediately. And folks, that's just not true. You're not living in a real world or reality if that's what you think. The best of the best were sick. The Apostle Paul was sick and afflicted and was never healed. And many others. So I don't care how saintly someone is, they're still going to suffer pain and suffering through this life and in this world until Jesus comes again in the clouds of glory. So we're going to take a look at the subject today, the pain, the problem of pain. Now, you don't have this in your title, but if you want to add to it, you could add to it the title of pain with the anticipation of glory. With the anticipation of glory. Because that's what the Apostle Paul is talking about here in this passage. And so let's take a look at it as a way of introduction a little bit before we read the scriptures here. This morning, we're going to be looking at verses 18 through 39, and our key text verse is verse 18. Paul says, following along with me if you would please, "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time," now right there, the Bible tells you we're going to suffer. So don't get this idea that you're never going to have a struggle with any, because Paul says it's going to in this present time, present tense. He says they are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. And that's our key text this morning, and we'll be looking at the other verses, but let us pray. Father, we thank you again for all that we've heard today. We've had church already. Lord, it's been great to be in your house today. What a healing it's been already. And lifting up the songs we've sung. And it is well with my soul. And heaven, we sing about going to heaven. And we thank you and we praise you for it. And thank you that he touched me and made me whole. Father, thank you that one day there will be no more pain, no more suffering, no more crying, no more tears, no more death. For the Bible says all these things shall be passed away. And I make all things new. Lord, in the meantime, we have to struggle with pain and suffering, and I trust we can gain something from it today and some understanding for it. Have your will and way in this service. Father, please bring to remembrance the things that we have studied and bring to our mind, and thank you for the Holy Spirit that always comes and helps us. He anoints us, he illuminates us. We thank you and we praise you for it. Now, Holy Spirit, help us with this message today that Jesus might be lifted up and glorified through it all. Somebody might be saved. Somebody help today. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. I mean, would you agree that everybody knows pain? Everybody knows pain. Matter of fact, our world today, if you just look around you, is suffering when suffering with pain. Look on the news every day. Look what's happening. Look at the family that just lost their child, and perhaps the mother, the lady in the car. That family today is going through pain. Look at the television and all the news and everything that's happening around the world. Matter of fact, there are hundreds of thousands of Christians today being martyred in Northern Korea for the cause of Christ. I mean, there are people all over the world that are suffering. Look at the television, look at these families, and look at all these beheadings that are going on with ISIS and all of this stuff, and the families of these people that are having to watch this on television, see this to their loved ones. There's going to be suffering and pain. We struggle sometimes. Why? How come? Especially those of us that are saved, and perhaps we serve the Lord and are living for the Lord, and perhaps even in his work, we wonder, God, why has this happened to me? After all, I'm your servant, and we serve you, and we live for you, and we honor you, and we've given our lives to you. Why are we going through this pain and suffering? Of course, everything God does is for a reason. It's a teaching lesson always to teach us something, to trust him more, to lean upon him more, to call upon him more, to strengthen, to grow our faith. And the main two, I believe, is to conform us to the image of Christ, and then so that God gets the glory in the end. It's really what it's all about. But today the world's full of it, and if we don't have answers sometimes for suffering, then I think sometimes we become discouraged, and that will lead to rebellion and bitterness in our lives. I found an interesting article about the atheists and agnostics. This one really killed me. I kind of laughed a little bit at it first because I thought it was hilarious a little bit. Atheists and agnostics say that pain exists because one of these three things is correct about God. Now, why would they even reference God since they don't believe in him? The atheists don't believe he exists, and the agnostics believe that he's unknown and you can't know him. But yet, here they reference to him that they're one of these three things, and here's what they say. Mainly the agnostics say here that God has no power over it. That God has no power over pain. They also say that God does not care enough to stop it. And, and then our wonderful atheists come along and say that God does not exist. May I say to you, all three of those answers are wrong. God has power, all power, over heaven and earth. He has all power over diseases and sicknesses with no problem. That's not a problem for him. By the way, I want to tell you, assure you something this morning on the authority of God's word. God cares for you. He cares for the little sparrow, the Bible says, when he sees him fall. In Luke's gospel, Luke tells us he cares so much for us that every one of us, our hairs are numbered. Some of you lost some this morning combing. God didn't lose count because he knows every hair that's on your head this morning. And Peter says, oh, by the way, cast all your care upon him, for he careth for you. So you see, that's all a tummy rot. And the fact that God doesn't exist, they have a problem. God does exist, ladies and gentlemen. And you can trust me, he's sitting on the throne. He's in complete, absolute, sovereign control of this world and this universe. If you don't think so, you would have never made it through the night, first of all. We wouldn't even be standing on this planet today, because this planet is sitting at a 23-degree axis, and it's spinning at about 25,000 miles per hour, and you ask me why I'm not dizzy and still standing here. Why I haven't been flung off the globe. Because God's got everything in control. Everything is consistent of him, Colossians tells us. So let's take a look at this verse again and we'll pick it up. This is our key verse. For I reckon. Now that's an interesting word there, that word reckon. It means to count or to calculate or to compute. So Paul is doing some figuring here about pain in this passage of Scripture. He says, I reckon that the sufferings. Now that's another interesting word. In other words, Paul is taking consideration, he's computing, he's taking into account, he's figuring out some things here for us. In light of the light sufferings that we go through, he said they are nothing compared to the glory that awaits us. You see, folks, now you really want to get into it heavier, and we don't have time, and I wish we did. Paul's really dealing with salvation in this whole passage. See, everything's about salvation and being saved. You see, I've only experienced two parts of my salvation right now. I have been justified, saved, born again, and I stand righteous before God. I have been sanctified. I have been set apart for God's service. That's justification and sanctification. But I have yet to experience the third part of my salvation, which is glorification. And that's what I long for and hope for, is to be glorified one day, to be just like Jesus. That hasn't come yet. So Paul says, in light of what is ahead. Tell me, church, what's ahead for you? In light of your light affliction, the pain and suffering that you and I are going through, Paul said that is nothing compared to the glory that awaits us. And I don't mean just to be in glory. You're going to be glorified. You're going to have a body just like Jesus. I'll tell you, no more pain, no more death, no more sorrow, no more crying, no more anything. A body just like his. And we await for that. But in the meantime, we got some struggles, don't we? So we need to go back and try to do with Paul here and find out the origin of pain and where it came from. So Paul begins here in verses 20 and 22, if you'll look at it with me. In verse 20, for the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who has subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. Paul takes us back and reminds us the reason or the origin for pain actually goes all the way back to the Garden of Eden, to the curse that was placed upon this planet. That's what he's talking about. So we want to see that yesterday's curse brings bondage. Yesterday's curse brings bondage. And Paul tells us that all of creation is in bondage. How much creation, church? All of creation is in bondage. All of creation is subject under the law of the curse of sin. You see, that's where it all originates from and where it comes from. And Paul's figuring this out and saying, if we could grasp a hold of this and get an understanding of why we have pain, why we suffer, he said, you need to understand it goes back to the Garden of Eden. It goes back to the fall of man, when God then placed this old planet under a curse and put it in bondage of sin because of the fall of Adam. It not only affected Adam, but it affected nature. It affected this planet. It affected the vegetation. It affected the animal kingdom, the plant kingdom, the human kingdom. You see, remember our message a few weeks ago on choices? Adam made a choice, didn't he? He had the free will to choose, did he not? He had the free will to choose to eat of the tree. That was his choice. But he didn't have the free will to decide what the consequences of the choice would be. You see, his choice determined the consequences. So he chose it, and as a result, it put the whole planet under a curse. You see, it affected him, his family, and it has affected everybody down through the ages until presently right now, the apostle tells us. So we see that Paul in this passage, he's trying to figure something. He says, all of creation is in bondage. And you find that in Genesis chapter 3, verses 17 through 18. By the way, I want to tell you something. God did not create a corrupt or sinful world. God did not create a corrupt or sinful world. Don't blame it on God. It wasn't his fault. It was Adam's. God didn't create it. Everybody's a Genesis 1:31. Now, this is after the sixth day of creation I'm taking you to. And God saw everything. How much did God see? Everything that what? He made. And behold, it was very good. And the evening was the morning, were the sixth day. So at the end of God's sixth day of creation, after God created and made everything, and man was created on the sixth day, that's the crowning of God's glory, was man. God said, boy, I saw this, and God says, wow, this is very good. But something happened. When we get into chapter 3, Adam messed up. By the way, let me tell you something else. Don't ever blame God that God is the author of evil or pain. God is not the author of evil and pain. I tell you, the pain, don't be blaming God for your suffering this morning. Now, I know, because I deal with people all the time with this, and part of this is part of my ministry now for 18 years. When I was Pastor Woodward's associate pastor for 5 years, part of my responsibility was hospital visits and the rehab and the nursing homes and all that, and checking on the people and so forth. And I learned a lot from them, and for 13 and a half years I've been doing it here, and it hasn't changed. And I've learned a little bit about this, that sometimes people get discouraged, sometimes they get upset, they get rebellious, and they want to blame God or want to put the blame on God for what's going on. God did not create evil. You understand that? God did not create pain. So don't blame God for it. God created man how? Perfect. You and I were created perfect in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 26 and 27 and 31. God created you and I perfect. We were perfect. We were created in the likeness and in the image of God himself. Do you understand that, folks? I'm not a tadpole. I'm not some amoeba that floated around in some scum pond for a few million billion years and then grew a tail and swam around for a few more, then jumped up on a lily pad and began to croak a little bit and decided I'm going to check out the land. And I landed from the lily pad to the land. And from there I decided, well, man, those trees are kind of interesting. I think I'll start crawling and climbing trees. And all of a sudden the tail began to grow and I climbed up in a tree and I'm swinging from the trees having a good time for a few million years, and then all of a sudden while I'm swinging around, my tail breaks off, and on the way down from the tree, I go past a Neiman Marcus suit factory, and I land on the ground on my 2 feet in a Neiman Marcus suit and say, finally, God, man, I have arrived, I've made it. Now, if you want to believe all that nonsense, you can. I'd like to believe that I was created and in the image and the likeness of God Himself. The Bible says, I am fearfully and wonderfully made. And so when we see each other, we see the image of God revealed in us. That's what Jesus was. Jesus was the direct, visible image of the invisible God. Oh, boy, I'll tell you what. And so here we go. When Adam sinned, now, he dragged the entire creation down with him. You agree with me on that? Genesis chapter 3, turn to it. We're going to go to Genesis chapter 3. You've got them there in your notes, but stay there in Romans because we'll be back. But get over to Genesis chapter 3. We're trying to understand a little bit of the origin of pain and its beginning and so forth to help us understand, to help answer some answers as to why we have pain and go through it. Everybody in Genesis chapter 3. All right, Genesis chapter 3, if you would, please. First of all, when Paul said that all of what? All of creation was dragged down in to this curse of sin, of the bondage that gave it to us. Look at there. First of all, number one, there is the curse on the animal kingdom. There was a curse that was put on the animal kingdom. We find that in chapter 3 and verse 14. And the Lord God said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art, say it with me, church, thou art what? Cursed. Now, who God did? God put the curse on him. Above all the cattle and above every beast of the field, upon thy belly shall thou go, and dust shall thou eat all the days of thy life. So first of all, when Adam sinned, and Adam fell into sin by choice, by the way, Eve made that choice too, but she wanted to blame the serpent. Adam wanted to blame the devil, the woman. The woman blamed the devil, and Adam blamed the woman, and God said, no, you both are guilty. You disobeyed and rebelled against me, and therefore you've plunged this whole planet into a curse of bondage. Because why? The wages of sin is death. God demands the death penalty for sin. And so this world was put under a curse. So even the animals are under a curse today. That's why they have pain and suffer, the animals. They're under a curse. Then number two there's a curse on the mineral kingdom. Look at verse 17 of Genesis chapter 3. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, oh boy, and has eaten of the tree of which I've commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Here it is. Talk to me. Cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow thou shalt eat of it all the days of thy life. So the mineral, earth, the soil was put under a curse and bondage. See, Paul's taking us back. He said, here's why we suffer. Here's why we have these light afflictions. Here's why we go through what we go through, because it goes all the way back to the curse of bondage, to the Garden of Eden. And he says he's taking us back and explaining things to us. Well, we come to verse 18, and we see here there's a curse on the vegetable kingdom. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. So you see, he's covering all of creation. So the animal kingdom was cursed, the mineral kingdom was cursed, the vegetation or vegetable kingdom was cursed, and then we come to the fourth one there in verses 16 and 17. Let's go back and read it again. And we find that the human kingdom was cursed. Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception in sorrow. Thou shalt bring forth children, and their desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and so forth. And there we find that God placed a curse on the human kingdom. You see, we're under the curse and the bondage of sin. That's why the Bible says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That's why our brother James says in James 1:15, he said, when sin is finished, it bringeth forth death. That's why over in Ezekiel chapter 18, I believe it is, Ezekiel the prophet says, the soul that sinneth, it shall surely die. You see, we're under the bondage of the curse of sin that brings forth death. Doesn't sound too good right now, does it? So that's why we go through all what we go through. And we need to understand that. And I hope that you do. That's why Paul put it this way in Romans chapter 5. Wherefore, as by one man's sin. Now, who was that? See, he just got through telling us in verse 8, he's taking us all the way back to creation, to Genesis chapter 3, and he said, here's the problem. The problem started in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve. So by one man's sin, what did that man do? He sinned. He disobeyed and rebelled against God. Sin entered into the what? The world, the cosmos. And death by sin. And so death passed upon all men, for all have sinned. That's why the Bible says when sin is finished, it bringeth forth death. That's why the Bible says the soul that sinneth, it shall die. So to help me this morning, church, to understand why I'm going through some pain and suffering, and will continue to do so until Jesus comes, Paul calls them light afflictions because it goes back to yesterday's curse of bondage that this old world was placed under by Adam. And so I can trace it back there. So you see, now, if you want to put any blame on anybody, blame Adam. See, don't blame God today for what's going on. It's Adam's fault. By the way, don't blame society either. Don't blame the government. Maybe it's wrong and it's crooked and everything else that it is. You see, it's not that. We've got to go back to Paul says he's taken us back here in Romans. He says, hey, here's the origin of it. Here's where it started. Here's where it came from. And so if we can understand that I'm going through what I'm going through, I'm struggling what I'm through, because it goes back to something that basically I wasn't there and I didn't personally have any fault, the problem involved in it, but Adam did. And because of what he did, it was passed on to me. And so now I'm struggling with it. And that will help us. But we have some good news now. Go back to Romans, where we were at. Let's take a look at tomorrow's conquest brings liberty. How many of you want liberty today? Paul talks about that as he begins to talk to us again. He tells us there's going to be some changes made. He said there's going to be something that's going to happen as we move on into the future that's going to bring liberty. Because why? We're under bondage right now. And I tell you, men need to be set free from the bondage of sin. And Christ can bring that liberty to them and offer that to them. But let's take a look at it in verses 21 here through 23. And back in Romans again, Paul gives us tomorrow's conquest brings liberty. Because the creature itself also shall be what? Talk to me. Shall be what? Creation is going to be delivered. Can somebody say amen? Okay? Creation is going to be delivered. What he says here in verse 21, from the bondage of corruption. Now watch this. We're going to earth, this whole planet of all of creation one day is going to be delivered from the bondage of the corruption that has come upon it, and it's going to be changed into the glorious liberty of God. Hallelujah. You see that in verse 21. Now say it with me. For we know, Paul says, that the whole what? The whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until right now, presently. In other words, this whole planet today, folks, you're not the only one that's struggling with sickness or ailment or illness today and that you're hurting. Many of us are in here this morning. We're just not just us. Everybody's included in this thing. Man, the plant kingdom is. The trees out here, the lawn, the minerals, the atmosphere, the whole planet is groaning today and groaning to be delivered from the curse of the bondage that it's in. And Paul says it's going to happen. He said there's going to be something that's going to take place that the whole planet's going to be delivered one of these days. Hallelujah. And it'll be in the return of the Lord Jesus Christ when he comes back and sets up and establishes his millennial kingdom. Everything's going to change. You want change, America? Get in on this and you'll get changed. You want to change life today? Get saved and born again today and trust the Lord Jesus Christ and let him change and give you a new life and a new home and a new hope. And yeah, there'll be some struggles still along the way. You'll still have some sickness along the way. But oh, bless God, you got heaven to look forward to. You got glorification to look forward to. See, that's our blessed hope. So there's going to be a change, man. Look at verse 22, for we know. And then verse 23. And watch this. Now all of creation is going to be changed in verse 22, right? Are you with me? Say amen. Verse 23. And not only they. What's that? That's creation. But watch this. But ourselves also. Can somebody say that's me? You're going to be changed. Watch this. Which have the first fruits of the Spirit. See, you just got the first fruits, which implies there's much more to come. You know the first fruits that I've received thus far? Justification. I've been saved. You know the second fruits that I've seen in this first fruits? Sanctification. I've been sanctified, but that's just the first fruits. I'm awaiting the rest of the fruit, and that's glorification. Hallelujah. Boy, I tell you, this is good stuff. I love the book of Romans. This is Paul's masterpiece. So we see here, A there, if you're studying and following along, the world is going to be, talk to me, church, changed when? For the better when? When Jesus comes again. Paul said this old planet's going to be restored. And that's going to take place in the millennium. When Jesus establishes his earthly kingdom here, the millennial kingdom in Jerusalem, and for 1,000 years this planet's going to be changed. But I'm going to get changed before then. I'm planning on going up 7 years earlier. I'm going up in the rapture of the church. I know there's a lot of you out there who don't believe in the doctrine of the rapture. I feel sorry for you. Amen. Stay here if you want to, but I'm leaving. Man, if all I got to look forward to is the tribulation period, where is my blessed hope? Boy, that's nothing to be hopeful about. That's nothing to get excited about. That's nothing to look forward to, that I'm going to have to go through hell itself during the 7 years of tribulation. Oh, come on, man. I'm getting out of here. You want to stay behind? That's your business. You will if you don't get saved. If you don't get saved, you'll be left behind. And don't say, well, I'll get saved then. No, you won't. If you won't get saved now, you won't get saved then. It's easy to get saved today, folks. Put your faith and trust in Christ and turn from your sin and repent of your sin and invite Jesus into your heart and life and be saved and born again into the family of God and to the kingdom of God. It's easy. It's not hard. You're going to have a tough time during tribulation. Matter of fact, if you've already heard the gospel and understood it, it's too late. The Bible makes it clear that God will send a strong delusion and cause you to believe the lie of the Antichrist. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Now is the accepted time. Don't put it off. Boast not thyself for tomorrow. You don't know what tomorrow may bring, my friend. Harden not your heart in the day of visitation when God comes to visit you today with his salvation. Don't harden your heart. If you hear his voice, come to him today. Well, that's the message. We need to get people saved. So we see the animal kingdom is going to be changed. Now, we go to Isaiah chapter 11. I'm not going to read those for you, but I gave you the verses there. Isaiah chapter 11, verses 6 through 9, tells us that the animal kingdom is going to be changed. And Isaiah's talking about the millennial kingdom during that time. So if you want to open that up to your Bible and put a little note in there, those verses, put the millennial kingdom. And we'll look at a couple others because we just have single verses for them. The mineral kingdom will be changed. Isaiah 35, 1. The wilderness and the solitary place shall be glad for them, and the desert shall rejoice and blossom as a rose. That's in the millennial kingdom. Then the vegetable kingdom will be changed. Isaiah again in verse 55, chapter 55 and verse 13 says this, instead of the thorn shall come up the fir tree, and instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle tree, and it shall be to the Lord for a name, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. I'm telling you, this world is going to change. You see, there's going to come a time. There's tomorrow's conquest, my friend, brings liberty. You see, yesterday's curse brings bondage, but tomorrow's conquest brings liberty. Amen. And then we notice the human kingdom will be changed. Follow along there in those verses, if you would, please. And you take them, put them in your Bible. But 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 52. Notice what the Bible says. The Apostle Paul says in a moment, now he says in verse 51, he says, behold, look and see, I show you a mystery. He says, for we shall not all sleep, but we shall be, talk to me somebody, changed. But what? We shall be changed. We're not all going to sleep. We're not all going to taste physical death here, my friend. One of these days, the trumpet's going to sound and we're out of here. And we're going to change. I'm praying for it this year. The scientists tell us that the rapture is going to take place in September. That's interesting that we got scientists telling us that the rapture of the church is going to take place this September. They tell us that there's this huge asteroid coming and going to hit this planet in September. And that one of them said, well, that's just the coming of the Lord for the rapture of the church. And it's interesting that that's going to take place with the fourth blood moon of the nation of Israel. It's going to take place with Rosh Hashanah, of the last of the Feast of the Trumpets, of the announcing of a king, all in September. I'm telling you, I'm not setting dates or times, but I can know the season. And he said, you can know that it's even near at the door, he said. And you need to start looking up, for the signs are all around us, in the sun and the moon and the stars, and all that Jesus said would take place, they're all happening simultaneously around the world. And he says, when you see all this, you'd better look up, because your redemption draweth nigh. We better look up, that we're going to be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump of God, you see, my friend. And the trumpet shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall be raised, and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the air to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Somebody give the Lord a praise in this house today. I'm telling you, Jesus is coming in the clouds of glory, and you're going to be changed. Now, regardless, Paul says, in light of all of this, he says, you got to understand where he's going to. In light of all of your affliction and your pain and suffering, he says, hang on, because it's going to get better. We all think it's going to get worse. How much more can I take? How much more sickness and illness and pain can I handle, Lord? I mean, you promised me you wouldn't put any more on me than I can bear. How much do you think I can bear? Or I can't take any more of this. Hey, man, Paul says, don't worry about it. Something greater's coming. Don't lose hope that Jesus is coming, friend. He's coming. Whether it be September or today, he could come today, amen? That'd be fine with me. Wait till we give the invitation, because there's some people got to get saved out here that are watching television and listening on the radio, and they'll still be able to listen to it after I'm gone. You see, my friend, oh, praise God, somebody gets saved today. Then let the Lord come, amen. Revelation chapter 21 and verse 4, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be, talk to me, church, any more pain. Why? For the former things are passed away. I'm telling you, it's going to be changed. Revelation 22:3 says, and there will be no more curse. You see, in other words, tomorrow's conquest is going to bring liberty, not only for this planet, in the animal kingdom, and the mineral kingdom, and the vegetable kingdom, and the human kingdom. It's going to bring deliverance and liberty for all. Oh, thank God for it. Well, lastly this morning, let's take a look at today's comfort. We looked at the past, we've looked at the future. You say, well, preacher, what about the present right now where I live? Well, we're going to talk about that right now. Are you ready? Today's comfort brings hope. How many of you believe that? Today's comfort brings hope. Look at verse 24. For we are, talk to me. What? Thank you, Pastor, you're saved. Got one man saved here this morning. For we are saved. Are you with me? How many believe you're saved? How are we saved? By hope. My faith and hope is built in nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness, you see. All other ground is sinking sand. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. But hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth yet he hope for? But if we hope for that which we see not, then we do with patience wait for it. What's he talking about? Remember what he said back in verse 18? We're going to suffer a little bit for affliction now. And he said, that's nothing compared to the glory which shall be revealed in us. You know what we're hoping for? See, the Bible gave me security of my salvation right there. We are saved. You can't get any more secure than that. I'm secure in Christ today. Praise God. I've got two parts of my salvation. I'm looking forward to the next. That's my hope, you see. Paul said, we're saved by hope, and we look for that hope to be like Christ, glorification. And that's what we're looking forward to, my friend. And that's the joy of this whole thing. What a comfort to know that, oh, we got much more that lies ahead that's even going to be greater. My salvation is secure, but it's yet not seen. That's why we have this matter of hope. See, I haven't seen the fullness of my salvation yet. Neither have you. Anybody here been glorified yet and you're here today? I'd like to meet you. But that's what I'm looking forward to. Verse 22, he says, he talks about the groaning of the creation. He talks about the groaning of the believer. In verse 23, he talks about the groaning of the Holy Spirit. Look at the three groanings he talks about here. Today's comfort brings hope. Verse 22, For we know that the whole creation groaneth. So we see that creation groans today. Look at verse 23. And we ourselves, what do? Well, look at it. It says, even we ourselves, talk to me, church, groan, verse 23 of Romans, within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. You see, my soul has been redeemed, but my body is still in this flesh. And my body has not been redeemed yet. That's why I struggle and fight with the flesh just like you do. And so you see, Paul says, listen, all of the planet is groaning. The trees are groaning. The planets are groaning. The animals are growing. The vegetation's growing. Everybody's groaning until the redemption of all of it. And that's what we're waiting for, is the redemption of this whole setup that Paul's talking about, including, Paul says, even we as believers. Here's the saintly Paul, the greatest Christian ever walked on the planet, says, we groan within ourselves waiting for this body to be redeemed. Notice he didn't say waiting to be saved. He said we're already saved. He's waiting for this body to be redeemed one day in the clouds of glory. And I'm telling you, for the church in the rapture, it could be today. We will be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. Oh, my friend, I'm telling you, I'm excited about it. Even in all the pain and suffering we're going through. By the way, God's choice is saints still suffer, amen? Then he says the Holy Spirit groans. Look at verse 26 and 28. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with what? Groanings which cannot be uttered. The Spirit of God intercedes for you and I, and Jesus intercedes for the Holy Spirit. Where's Jesus? Talk to me. All right, he's seated at the right hand of God the Father, is he not? And he's interceding for the Holy Spirit, who intercedes for you and I, because where's the Holy Spirit live? He lives in me. And even though I don't even know how to pray, sometimes the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, knows exactly. And the Bible, and don't take this verse out of here and say this is speaking in tongues, because that's not true. That's not what this verse is talking about. Don't use that passage in this verse to say, well, see, the Spirit of God is causing me to speak in tongues from within. No. The Holy Spirit of God knows what your heart is. He knows what you're thinking. He knows the suffering, the pain that you're going through, and you don't even have words on how to pray it. And the Holy Spirit of God begins to say those groanings that only the Lord Jesus can hear and receive, and Jesus hears them at the throne, at the altar, and God answers our prayers. Hallelujah. So you see, creation groans, believers groan, the Holy Spirit even groans, the Comforter. That's why 1 Peter 5:7 says, what? Casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. Friend, the pain that we suffer today is simply temporary. And I know some of you are saying, well, I wish it would end real quick. I'd hope this temporary gets over right quick. Well, that's all right, it's only temporary, Paul says, in light of what's coming. Amen. Oh, praise God. I'm telling you now, in closing, look what it says here, verses 16 and 17. I want you to see three glorious truths. As we go back to verse 18, look what verse 18 says, and then we'll go back to the other verses. Paul says, for I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. I want you to learn three things about glory today. Are you ready? Look at verses 16 and 17 with me, if you would, please. You see, the Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are, what, church, talk to me, the children of God. How many of you are a child of God today? You're saved and born again. You're a child of God. Look at verse 17. And if children, then what? Heirs. Heirs of who? Heirs of God. And joint heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. I want you to know, when Paul talked about verse 18, that we reckon this glory that's yet to come, I want you to know, according to verses 16 and 17, you are prepared for glory. You are prepared for glory. Now, you ought to be able to say that. You ought to be able to, this morning, in light of everything we're going on, be able to say, look and say, man, I'm prepared for glory. You know how you got prepared for glory? Because you got saved. Isn't that what he said? If you're an heir and you're a joint heir with Christ and joint heir with God, if you've been saved, then guess what? You're going to be glorified, so you're prepared for glory. Now, those of you that are watching by television this morning, and those of you that are listening on the radio and the internet and iPads and iPhones and tablets and all that, listen to me. If you want to be prepared for glory, you got to get saved first. A man or woman has to be in Christ. And then when you become a child of God, a son and daughter of God, then guess what? You're going to be glorified. Therefore, you have made preparation. You're prepared for glory. That's the only way you're going to get prepared is by getting saved. See, people need to get saved. Notice what else now. I like this one. And we won't get into the doctrine of this, but it'll help you. Look at verses 28 through 30 with me. Romans chapter 8, verses 20. Let me give you the second truth about glory. Everybody ready for the second truth? And we know. Say that. And we know, what is it that we know? That all things work together for good to them that love God, to them that are called according to his purpose. In other words, you see, those that God loves, he calls according to his purpose, and those that he's called has answered the call. For whom he did foreknow, say, God foreknew me. Oh, some of you aren't too sure of that. The Bible says that God knew me before my mother's womb. I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Hallelujah. For whom he did foreknow, he also did what, church? Now, what did he predestine you to be? To be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn of many among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called. And whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified. Now, I don't have time to this morning. It doesn't permit and allow me to go into the doctrine of election here and foreknowledge and foreordain. Just taking the fact that God knows you, God called you, God's saved you, God predestined you to be in all of this, and he's predestined you to be glorified and to go to glory with it. I'm telling you, it's just wonderful. Who are those who love God? Those who are called according to his purpose. The called are the believers, verse 28. God has a plan that spans from eternity past to eternity future. Those he did foreknow refers to those whom God set his electing love upon in eternity past. Predestinate means that God planned from eternity that those he foreknew would become like Christ, that's to conform to the image, through the spiritual birth, the being born again. And called is the effectual call in which God opens our hearts so that we can hear his voice. And then calling is a sovereign summons that God draws a sinner from death unto life. That's why John said in John 15, and unless the Spirit draws a man, you can't be saved. And so I'm thankful this morning. God's not only prepared me for glory because I'm saved and born again, he has predestined me to glory. To them he predestined, he glorified. I'm predestined to be glorified into the image of Christ and to have a body just like the Lord Jesus Christ. Wow, that's why Paul says, in light of these sufferings, of these afflictions, he said, things are going to get better, brother. You've got a lot more to look forward to. And then I want you to notice, lastly, in verses 33 and 34. Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? How many of you guys say I'm God's elect? If you're a believer, you're God's elect. Okay? All those terms, election, I refer to the believer. Even over in Ephesians, you want to study the doctrine of election. It refers to the believer. It is God that justifieth. See, God's the justifier. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather that he is risen. Amen? Who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. See, Christ makes us intercession for us. All right, so watch this. Now drop down to verse 38 and 39. Paul says, for I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. In other words, not only am I prepared for glory because I'm saved, not only have I been predestined to be glorified by Christ because of that benefit, but I'm also preserved for glory. I'm preserved for glory. Nothing's going to separate me. Nothing. Not even death itself. Oh, I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, we have a marvelous salvation, a complete salvation. and the pain and suffering and sorrow that we attend and go through now, Paul says in verse 18, he said, listen, these light afflictions are nothing compared to the glory that's to be revealed in us. We are prepared for glory. We're predestined to glory, and we're preserved for glory. That's the third part of your salvation, glorification. And it's coming soon, my friend, when Jesus comes in the clouds of glory. Bow your heads and close your eyes. Let me have a moment here just to talk to our television audience for just a moment. Give them the opportunity to come to Christ today. Those of you that are listening and are with us right now, we want you to be saved and come to the Lord today. We want you to be changed. We want you to know the Lord Jesus Christ, and to whom to know is life everlasting. We desire for you to pass from death unto life. We desire you to have a relationship in Jesus Christ. And friend, if you've never done that, you've never made that commitment to come to Christ, would you do so right now? Would you let us help you this morning? We're going to say a prayer, and now it's not the prayer that saves you. That's communication with God, words with God. What saves you is putting your faith and trust in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary, of trusting Him and Him only to save you, to redeem you, to give you eternal life. But the Bible says we must believe, we must confess, we must call, we must receive. So we're going to do that through this prayer. So if this is the desire of your heart this morning, those of you that are watching and listening around the globe, would you pray with us this prayer, please? Simply just say, dear God, that's right, go ahead. I confess to you that I'm a sinner, and I ask you to forgive me and cleanse me, and He will, my friend. I confess with my mouth that you are the Lord. I do now believe in my heart that you died on the cross for my sin. You took my place. You paid my sin debt. I believe you were buried and that you rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. Right now, by faith, I do call upon you, Lord Jesus, and receive you into my heart and life to be my Lord and my Savior, and to take me to heaven someday when I die or at the rapture of the church. And I pray this prayer in faith, believing in Jesus' name, amen and amen. Now, if you prayed that prayer with us, God bless you. You're now in the family of God. You're a child of God. You're a joint heir with Christ. Glory will one day. Those of you that prayed that, you just got justified. You just got sanctified, and one day you will be glorified. That's what awaits you in heaven. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May He cause His face to shine upon you in the days ahead. God bless you so much for being with us and watching and tuning in. May the Lord bless you and keep you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen.